Recorded Books presents a griot audio production of The Preacher's Son by Carl Weber. This unabridged recording is narrated by Cherise Boothe, Peter J. Fernandez, J.D. Jackson, Lizan Mitchell, Nyambi Nyambi, and Myra Lucretia Taylor, and directed by Jeff Barron. Griot Audio celebrates the best in contemporary African-American fiction and nonfiction. This book is copyrighted 2005 by Carl Weber. This recording is copyrighted 2005 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Griot Audio. Bishop Wilson is running for borough president on a family values platform. But the values of his own family come into question when his son starts dating a stripper and his daughter gets pregnant by a married man. But the bishop is in no position to judge. He has a few skeletons of his own. And now, The Preacher's Son.
Prologue. Family Values. Bishop T.K. Wilson paused for effect and looked down upon the crowd of people. He took a breath and repeated his words in his strong baritone voice. Family values. Family values. Each repetition was more animated than the last. He was holding a microphone in one hand, waving a Bible in the other as he moved back and forth across the stage in what he liked to call his preacher's strut. What has happened to family values in this community? In this country, he shouted, then paused again as if expecting a response from his audience. T.K. Wilson was the pastor of First Jamaica Ministries, arguably the largest African-American church in Queens, New York. A tall, handsome man with chiseled features and a well-maintained salt-and-pepper beard, he was not only a very good minister and administrator, but a dynamic speaker as well. You could almost see him reeling in each and every one of the 500 or so people who'd flooded into Roy Wilkins Park for the free hot dogs, sodas, and balloons for the kids that his church was giving away. It was all part of First Jamaica Ministries' voter registration campaign. This year, the registration campaign was even more crucial, because it was also the year that their pastor hoped to become the next borough president of Queens.
I'll tell you what has happened to this country and this community, T.K. continued. They've gone to hell in a handbasket. That's what's happened to them. And why have they gone to hell in a handbasket?
He used his signature dramatic pause again, then emphasized his words with a wave of his hands.
Because this community has no role models. No one to look up to. No one they can go to when there's a problem. No one they can rely on to make sure your children and homes are safe. And to be quite frank, no one who cares.
He lowered his voice.
Well, brothers and sisters, that ends today, right here and now.
He pointed to the stage before him.
Because if no one else will step up and be the role model that this community needs, then I will. And that's why I'm running for Queensborough president.
There was an immediate explosion of applause, and everyone in the audience rose to their feet. When the crowd finally calmed down, the bishop smiled.
Thank you. Thank you so very much.
He took a handkerchief out of his breast pocket and wiped the sweat from his forehead before continuing.
For almost 17 years, I've been the pastor of First Jamaica Ministries, and I've tried to lead by example. During that time, I've accomplished quite a bit. We've built senior homes, a school, Section 8 housing for the needy, a free health clinic for the children, and we even have a homeless shelter for those who need to come in out of the cold. And if I'm elected borough president, I think I can do more.
There was some applause, and an older woman yelled from the crowd,
"We love you, Bishop!"
"Well, thank you, Sister Adeline. I love you, too. However, I need more than your love. I need your help. I need all of your help. I need you to go over to that table and register to vote. Register so that when Election Day comes, I won't just be a role model for First Jamaica Ministries, but a role model for the entire community, the entire borough of Queens. The crowd exploded into another round of cheers. First, a few voices started. Then it seemed like every voice in the crowd was chanting, "Bishop! Bishop! Bishop!" Bishop Wilson stood there, smiling proudly. For a moment, he felt like the most powerful man in the world. It was a strange feeling for him, because he'd never aspired to be involved in politics. That had been his now-deceased father-in-law, Reverend Dr. Charles Jackson's dream, not his. Reverend Jackson had been TK's mentor and predecessor as pastor of First Jamaica Ministries, and had always dreamed of seeing his son-in-law hold office. TK's only ambition had been to serve the Lord and be the best husband and father that he could be. TK glanced to the right side of the stage and smiled at his wife, Charlene, the only child of Reverend Jackson. She gave him a subtle thumbs up, making TK's smile widen. TK and Charlene had been married for over 20 years and had a good, blessed life as the pastor and first lady. She took her position as first lady very seriously, and in truth, she was just as responsible for TK's rise to power in the church as he was. It was Charlene who went to her father's deathbed and secured a letter to the deacon's board asking them to forego interviews with other ministers and name her husband the next pastor of the church. It was a decision that the deacon's board reluctantly agreed to, only out of respect for their deceased pastor. Years later, though, they had not once regretted the decision. Charlene was also responsible for raising a sizable donation for the near-bankrupt Northeast Black Church Council, First Jamaica Ministry's governing body. She then talked the council's trustee board into bestowing TK with the title of bishop and naming him to their board. There was no doubt that Charlene was dedicated to her husband's career, and she held high hopes for his future. Charlene, like her father, wanted to see TK embark on a political career. She had pushed him for years to run for office. He finally gave in when his good friend Helen Marshall, who stepped down as borough president due to term limits, asked TK to run. Charlene, of course, was thrilled with Helen's request, and some people even believed she had somehow orchestrated the whole turn of events. From his beautiful wife, the bishop glanced into the crowd at his lovely 20-year-old daughter, Donna, who was surrounded by young men, many of whom were eager to court the bishop's daughter. She was TK's pride and joy, his little princess, as he still called her. He was proud of the job he and his wife had done with her, and it saddened him to think that she was now a woman attending college, and he would soon be losing her to the young men of the world. He searched out his son, Dante, who was sitting behind a table helping people register to vote. Dante had just recently graduated from St. John's University with a degree in business administration. He was working for the First Jamaica Ministries as director of church activities, although his mother had much higher aspirations for him. It was her belief that someday Dante would step into his father's shoes as pastor of the church. This was also the bishop's hope, although he was a little more realistic about the situation than his wife was. He knew that being a minister was a calling, and he wasn't quite sure if his son had or would ever receive that calling. His wife, on the other hand, imagined that her son becoming pastor was a matter of birthright, and she would not hear of anything else.
Chapter 1. Dante. It was late afternoon when my best friend Shorty Jefferson and I rolled east down Jamaica Avenue in his metallic blue Jeep Cherokee. Shorty and I were rocking our heads to the music as we flirted with one pretty woman after another. We'd just finished handing out my father's campaign flyers in front of Gertz Plaza Mall, and the radio was blasting G-Units popping those things. The bass was so loud that not only could nearby pedestrians hear the music, they could feel it, too. When Shorty stopped at a traffic light, I winked at a beautiful 20-something-year-old woman who'd pulled up next to us in a red Honda Civic. She winked back with a smile. I gestured for her to roll down her window, then turned toward Shorty, my face now flushed with color. One thing was for sure. She was as fine as they came.
"Yo, check out baby over here in the Civic," I yelled, reaching for the button to roll down the window.
I turned back in her direction, smiling as if I were on a toothpaste commercial. I wasn't a real believer in picking up women off the street with corny-ass lines, but this sister was worth taking a shot at. "What's up, baby girl? Can a brother get them digi?" I stopped myself abruptly and Shorty fell out laughing. I hadn't seen quite what I was expecting. Oh, there was a woman there all right, but it wasn't the fine sister I'd been flirting with just seconds before. She and her red Civic had made an illegal right on red and were halfway around the corner. In place of her car was a black Lincoln Continental. The driver was a mocha-colored, heavy-set woman in her late 50s, wearing a very expensive but ugly bronze-colored wig. Both Shorty and I knew her quite well, and by the scowl on her face, it was clear she didn't appreciate my comment, our music, or Shorty's laughter in the background. Her name was Deaconess Lillian Wright, better known in whispers around my father's church as the Bitch. She was one of my mother's closest friends, along with being one of my father's biggest political supporters. "How you doing, Deaconess?" I raised my hand as I smiled meekly. She remained stone-faced, offering no reply. I rolled the window up and turned back toward Shorty, who'd stopped laughing and was back to rocking his head to the music.
"Shorty, turn the radio down,"
I told him through gritted teeth.
"What?"
Shorty shouted, obviously wondering why I was whispering.
"I said turn the motherfucking radio down,"
I yelled this time. Then I reached for the volume knob, turning the radio down myself. I turned back toward Deaconess Wright, who was already punching the buttons on her cell phone. I knew that could only mean one thing, trouble, especially when I saw her flailing her other arm as she yelled into the phone. I wasn't a lip reader, but her mouth looked like it was forming the word drunk several times. I sank into the seat, wishing I could take back the last few minutes of my life. The light turned green, but before Shorty could hit the accelerator, Deaconess Wright swerved out of the right turn lane and into his, speeding down Jamaica Avenue and turning on Merrick Boulevard.
"Oh, shit!"
I slammed my hand on the dashboard.
"Man, I bet that bitch is headed straight to the church to see my mama."
"So what?" Shorty shrugged.
"So what? Do you realize how much trouble I'm gonna get into?"
I screwed up my face with disgust as I imagined the choice words my mother would have for me when I got to the church.
"Trouble for what?"
Shorty sighed, rolling his eyes at me.
"How old are you, Dante?"
"Man, you know how old I am," I snapped with attitude.
"Same age as you."
"Okay.
So you old enough to drink in this state and buy cigarettes, right?"
Shorty asked sarcastically.
"Yeah, what's the point, Shorty?"
"The point is..." Shorty took his eyes off the road and glared at me.
"Why the fuck are you so worried about some old church biddy with droopy titties calling your mama? You a grown man. What's your mom's gonna do, give you a beating?"
I hesitated before I responded as if that was exactly what I was afraid of.
"Look, Shorty, I've been trying to explain this to you for years. Everything that my sister Donna and I do is a reflection of my parents and a reflection of the church. My pops is Bishop T.K. Wilson, for crying out loud. He's one of the most influential ministers in the city, possibly even the state. Jesus, he's running for borough president."
"And? What's that supposed to mean? You know I like the bishop, Dante, but he ain't God. He's just a man. He likes pussy just like the rest of us heathens. Otherwise, you and your sister wouldn't be here." I couldn't help it. I let out a frustrated laugh. Shorty had a way with words that was always colorful, if not true. Hell, I still heard my parents doing their thing every once in a while late at night. You don't understand how hard it is being the bishop's son, Shorty. They all think I'm the heir apparent to the bishop. Yeah, and they're right. Except maybe for Reverend Reynolds. You the only candidate. But I don't want to be... Shorty cut me off. Don't even start that shit, Dante. Not unless you're willing to tell your folks the truth. I can't tell them the truth. Not yet, anyway. My mama wants me to be the pastor one day, and so does the bishop. I can't let them down. Let them down? What about letting yourself down, Dante? You got a damn near perfect score on the LSATs, and you don't even have the guts to apply to law school because of your parents. Shorty's face looked pained at the thought of me passing up that opportunity. Man, you need to stand up to your parents. Shit, man, you don't even want to be a minister. How you gonna be a pastor? I shrugged but remained silent. We'd had this conversation 100 times before, and the result was always the same. I ended up agreeing with Shorty, but I never actually had the nerve to admit to my parents my true aspirations. Shorty turned his attention back to the road, but not before he turned up the volume again. After a brief drive, he pulled his truck in front of the church and smiled as he stuck out his fist for me to tap. I smiled back as I tapped it, then stepped out of the truck and stretched. At an even 6'3" tall, I'm a well-built man with a basketball player's body and smooth, handsome, almond-colored features. I'm not trying to brag or anything, but everyone says I look like my dad minus the beard, and women have been calling him good-looking for as long as I can remember. My friend Shorty, not a bad-looking guy himself, isn't an inch over 5'6". He too is well-built, but with a darker mahogany complexion. His real name is John, but I can't remember anyone other than a few teachers calling him anything but Shorty since we met. He and I have been friends since the 6th grade, and much to my mother's chagrin, we've remained friends throughout the years. Yo, I'll check you later. Why don't we shoot by Scandalous, that new place in Long Island City, tonight? Please, you know I can't be seen in a place like that, I replied. Even if I didn't have to worry about my public image as the preacher's son, I wasn't in the mood to go to a strip club anyway. I didn't mind hanging out with Shorty, but lately I'd been looking for a woman to settle down with, and a strip club isn't exactly the kind of place you're gonna find a woman to take home to your mama. Yo, Shorty, why don't you come on in? Shorty never replied because a tall, voluptuous, olive-skinned woman exited the side door of the church, distracting him. She was wearing a short, black miniskirt and a tight-fitting red blouse. She was a big-boned woman with shapely thighs and a huge butt. She was what we brothers like to refer to as thick. Her name was Donna, my younger sister. Shorty had been infatuated with her for as long as I could remember. When we were younger, the two of them were actually pretty close. When Shorty couldn't find a date to the prom, he asked Donna and she went. You should have seen their prom picture. The two of them looked like Laurel and Hardy, my sister being a good 4 inches taller than him, even without her heels. Still, Shorty never seemed happier than he was that night at the prom with Donna. Hey, Donna. Shorty waved his hand eagerly. Donna waved back politely, then walked up to me and kissed my cheek. Hey, sis, what's up? My car's in the shop. Can I borrow yours, please? She gave me this sad, pleading look, then turned toward the church, watching the side door nervously. She must have been afraid my mother was going to pop out those doors and make her change her clothes. What she was wearing was pretty provocative, and I was surprised she got out of the house, let alone the church, without our mother's scrutiny. That's when the thought hit me that she had probably just changed in my office, which she had done before, and had been waiting by the window for my return so she could borrow my car and get out of Dodge. Where are you going dressed like that? I asked with brotherly concern.
I'm going to see my friend. We're going to dinner at the Soul Cafe on 42nd Street, she smiled.
Why? Is there a problem? She gave me that don't even go there after everything I've done for you look.
Donna had done everything from helping me sneak girls into our house to pretending my girlfriends were her friends so they could sneak into my room after our parents were asleep. The last thing I wanted to do now was be a hypocrite.
Nah, no problem, I said, trying to hold back my true feelings.
I just don't want you to get hurt, Donna. I hope you're taking the proper precautions.
Don't worry about that, because I took them right out your dresser drawer.
Donna blushed while I didn't even crack a smile.
I hated the thought that my sister might be having sex, but she was 20 years old, and there really wasn't anything I could do about it.
So, can I borrow your truck, Dante? Please? I gotta get out of here before Mommy comes out.
I stared at my sister, then handed her the keys to the new Lincoln Aviator truck my parents had given me as a graduation present.
Don't you get in no accident with my car.
I loved my sister, but she was a horrible driver. That was why her car was in the shop now.
I won't, I promise. Donna smiled, wrapping her arms around me and kissing me on the cheek. Oh, Dante, can you tell Mommy that I'm studying at Susan's?
I hesitated, then thought about how many times she'd lied for me. Yeah, sure. No problem.
Thanks.
She kissed me again, then waved.
Bye, Shorty.
Bye, Donna. Shorty and I watched her walk toward my car. Then he turned to me with an unhappy look on his face.
She's got a boyfriend, doesn't she?
Yep.
When did all this happen?
Shorty, like myself, had never known Donna to date. Matter of fact, after the prom, he pursued Donna for over a year. For a while, I thought they might even hook up for real. But for the past few years, Donna had been treating him like he barely existed. Even though it hurt Shorty, as far as I was concerned, it was a good thing. Best friends and sisters shouldn't be mixed. I shrugged my shoulders. I guess she's been seeing him for a couple of months.
What? Why didn't you tell me?
There was obvious jealousy in his voice. That was exactly why I hadn't told him. I stared at my lovesick friend.
Because it's none of your business. You don't go around telling me who your sister is dating.
Shorty rolled his eyes.
So who is this guy anyway?
I don't know. But whoever he is, he's got her nose wide open. She's used up about half the condoms in my drawer. I could see the disappointment in Shorty's face, and I felt sorry for him. He really liked my sister. I guess I just never knew how much until now, so I decided to try to take his mind off it.
Hey, man, forget about my sister. Why don't you come on inside?
The women's choir rehearsal's about to get out, and you know they're gonna have some food and some good-looking honeys down there. Shorty glanced over at Deaconess Wright's Lincoln Continental and my mother's champagne-colored Mercedes-Benz parked in the church's parking lot. I could tell my offer was tempting. We hadn't eaten all day, and a lot of those church girls were hot in the ass. Still, the look in his eyes said he really wasn't up for any drama. With my mom and Deaconess right around, there was sure to be some. If things went the way they usually did, Shorty would be the one who ended up getting blamed for it, too.
I think I'll pass, bro.
He pointed at the two cars in the church's reserved parking spaces. I guess he figured if he was going to deal with that, there was going to have to be a good reason. And that reason had just pulled away in my truck to see another guy.
It looks like you about to have some drama with your mama. Ain't no need for me to stick around. I'll just make things worse for you.
Chicken.
What? You scared of my mother?
I teased.
Pretty much.
He nodded.
I thought you said I should stand up to her. I said you should stand up to her. You her son. Me? I'm just a guy from around the block. Only time your mom's wants to see me is on Sunday morning, and that's only if I'm putting something in the collection plate. I chuckled. You know she loves you, Shorty. Yeah, like a snake loves a rat. Did you forget what she did last Saturday? I figured that was best left unsaid, so I remained quiet. I hoped Shorty would do the same, but he continued. Your mom's got on the mic at the church bazaar and told everyone who'd listened to hold on to their daughters because Satan just walked in. Then people started staring at me like I had horns and shit. Now, I've been called a lot of things, Dante. But to have the first lady of the church you belong to call you the devil has got to be the worst. I lowered my head, laughing at my mother's antics. Despite her actions, I really don't think my mother disliked Shorty. She just loved the hell out of me and didn't want to admit that I'm human and can make mistakes. It was easier for her to make Shorty the scapegoat for my missteps. She didn't mean anything by it, Shorty. Shorty rolled his eyes. Dante, face it, man. Your mom doesn't like me. She never has, and she probably never will. She thinks I'm a bad influence on you. Yeah, little does she know, I'm probably a worse one on you. We both laughed as I said goodbye and headed for the side entrance to the church.
Chapter 2. Donna. I entered the Soul Cafe on 42nd Street and headed straight for the bar, relieved that no one had stopped me to check my ID. I searched for an empty table. I was early for my date with Terrence, and I wanted to have a drink to calm my nerves before he arrived. Just the thought of being alone with him had me so excited that my hands were shaking. I'd been dating Terrence for a little over 4 months now, and he continued to have the same overwhelming effect on me as he had the first day we met. He was unlike any other man I had ever dated, and there was no doubt in my mind that I was in love with him. I spotted an empty booth on the other side of the bar where I was sure Terrence would see me. I immediately headed toward it. I could feel the eyes of almost every man in the place on me as I walked across the room. A few of them tried to stop me for idle chit-chat, but I ignored them and kept right on going. There wasn't anything in that room that interested me other than a drink, but those fools were persistent as hell. Maybe it wasn't a good idea for me to wear such a micro miniskirt, but Terrence had mentioned on more than one occasion that he liked seeing me in skirts because of my shapely legs. Truth is, I think he liked the easy access to what was under my skirt a little more. But either way, I was hoping that when he came in, he'd be pleased. I never imagined I'd end up being eye candy for every horny guy in Manhattan, though. Oh well, I guess that's just the price you pay when you're trying to please the man you love. I'd known I wanted Terrence the second he showed up at the church 2 years before. He was everything I'd ever hoped for in a man. He was handsome, caring, intelligent, funny, and as I would find out later, a phenomenal lover. Everything a girl would want to take home to her mama, that is, if her mama weren't a bitch like mine. From the moment I had shown an interest in boys, my mother made it clear that no one was good enough for her daughter. That was ironic, though, because it also seemed like no matter how hard I tried to please her, nothing I did was ever good enough for her. Anytime I was less than perfect, she would remind me what a disappointment I was. My mother was a hard woman to please, which is why I didn't make my interest in Terrence public knowledge. However, I wasn't the only one interested in him, and the others weren't shy about hiding their feelings. It seemed like every woman in the church was after him, including my best friend, Rashonda Wright. With all that competition, I had my work cut out for me just to get his attention, but I knew one day he was going to be mine. One day he was going to take my gift of virginity and make me his woman. I would just have to be patient. Besides, my real dilemma wasn't Rashonda or the other girls in the church. It was my mother, the biggest cock blocker in New York. The way she acted, you could have made a case that she wanted Terrence for herself. So unlike the other girls in the church, it took a little longer for him to notice me than I would have liked. I didn't mind, though, because after all those lonely Friday and Saturday nights I spent dreaming about him, Terrence finally asked me out to dinner, and we'd been a couple ever since. When I finally arrived at the booth, it didn't take long for the waitress to appear. I ordered an apple martini and drank about half of it before I nearly choked on what was left of it. I couldn't believe my eyes when I spotted Shorty headed my way. I was tempted to duck under the table, but by then it was obvious he'd seen me. 3 seconds later, he slid into the seat across from me and smiled. "Shorty, what are you doing here?" I whispered. My voice was filled with paranoia and agitation as I glanced around the bar, expecting Dante to pop up at any moment. "I heard you tell Dante where you were going," he replied. "You followed me?" My jaw dropped and my eyes were as wide as silver dollars. I glanced at my watch nervously. I only had about 10 minutes to get rid of him before Terrence showed up. "Yeah, I wanted to see if we had the same taste in women," he said sarcastically. "I mean, you are gay, aren't you? That's the excuse you used when you rejected me." There was anger in his eyes, and his voice was testy. "What are you getting an attitude about? You're not my man, and I do not appreciate you following me. My social life is my business, Shorty. I don't be chasing around after you and Dante when y'all be messing with them hoochies. Now, if you don't mind, I'm waiting here for someone, and you're sitting in their seat." I picked up my drink and turned my head toward the door. "You want me to leave? Okay, I'll leave. But I'm just going over to the bar to have a drink." He started to slide out of the booth, and I grabbed his arm with my free hand. "Go home, Shorty." "For what, Donna? Is there something you don't want me to see?" "No, I just don't want you to get hurt."
"Why? Are you seeing someone I know?"
"That's none of your business. Where's Dante? I know he's lurking around here somewhere." I changed the subject.
"He's at church."
"Well, thank God for small favors," I thought. "Good. Now go home, Shorty." I tried to convey my point with my most serious expression.
"You want me to leave, Donna? Okay, I'll go. But just answer one question for me." I was desperate, so I agreed with a nod.
"Why'd you lie to me?"
"Lie to you about what? I didn't lie to you, Shorty." "Yes, you did. You lied to me about being gay."
I looked around to see if anyone had heard him. "Who said I lied?"
"You did when you told Dante you took condoms out his drawer. Why'd you take the condoms out of his drawer if you're with a woman?"
I lowered my head because his face had, "Go ahead, tell me another lie," written all over it.
"Donna, you're not a lesbian. You know it, and I know. You're seeing a man."
Suddenly, I felt bad. Shorty and I had fooled around a little during my late teens. Nothing serious like Terrence and me, or even as serious as Dante and his ex Anita. Hell, I'd never even let Shorty get to third base. But as far as he was concerned, we were a couple. I didn't mind letting him have his little fantasy, though, as long as he didn't tell my brother or my parents about us. Truth is, I kind of liked pulling the wool over my mother's eyes, so everything was cool for a while. Our problem came when Terrence showed up at the church and captured my heart. From that point on, I had no interest in Shorty. That's when I told him that story about being gay. After that, he never pushed up on me again, and to my surprise, he was mature about it and kept it to himself. But I could tell from the way he looked at me now that he still cared. Don't get me wrong, I thought Shorty was a sweet boy, but that was just it. He was a boy, and Terrence was a man.
"So what's up, Donna? You messing with some dude, aren't you?"
"Shorty, I'm sorry. I was just trying not to hurt your feelings. I care about you."
He raised his hand to stop me so he could finish my sentence. "But just not the way I care about you, right?"
I nodded, and he frowned.
"So who is he? Do I know him?"
I didn't say a word. My facial expression said it all.
"We could have been good together, Donna. I would have done anything for you."
"I know that, Shorty, but sometimes what's good to you is not good for you.
Besides, it would have never worked.
Why not?
Because my mother and because of Dante. He doesn't want us to be together, Shorty. He never did. He's afraid he's gonna lose his best friend to his sister. I was trying to soften the blow, but Shorty wasn't making it easy.
Fuck Dante. Fuck your mother, too. I'm in love with you, Donna. You never even gave me a chance. Just give me a chance.
I'm sorry, Shorty, but I can't do that. I'm not in love with you. I'm in love with someone else. I felt so bad, and he looked so sad.
No one is ever gonna love you like I do, Donna. No one.
He got up from the seat and looked down at me with these sad, dark eyes.
Just remember this. One day, you're gonna end up on my doorstep looking for that love. You just better pray that I open the door.
I can't explain how bad I felt as I watched Shorty walk away. My sadness was not long-lived, though, because a few seconds after Shorty walked out the door, Terrence walked in. I waved at him in an attempt to get his attention. He glanced my way, but I don't think he saw me because this high yellow bitch was grinning in his face like she was a contestant for Miss Black America and he was one of the judges. I was tempted to get up out of my seat and snatch her fake-ass ponytail right out of her head, but Terrence had made it very clear that he didn't like drama. So I sat there and waited for my boo to notice me. Besides, I didn't have anything to worry about. He never disrespected me. Well, at least not until now. I couldn't believe my eyes when he leaned over and whispered something into that heifer's ear. And you better believe I was livid when her grinning ass handed him a piece of paper and he took out a pen and started writing. He might not have liked drama, but he was about to get some. I'd given that man my heart, not to mention my virginity. He was not going to make a fool out of me.
Excuse me, miss. Can I buy you a drink?
I looked up as a handsome 30-something-year-old man stepped directly in front of me, blocking my line of sight to Terrence and that bitch. He was dressed in a very expensive suit and looked like he probably made big bucks. Not that it mattered to me. He could have been Denzel Washington holding a suitcase full of money. The only thing that brother could do for me was move out of the way so I could see what that bitch was doing with my man.
Miss, can I buy you a drink? He inquired again politely.
No, I already have a drink, I told him with hostility as I leaned to my right in an attempt to see around him. Now, could you move out my way?
Well, do you mind if I sit down?
This guy just didn't get the hint. I was about 2 seconds from cursing his ass out. I don't care what you do, I sighed. I just want you to get out of my way. Can't you see I'm trying to look at something? Now move.
I guess he got the message because he finally walked away.
When he did, I almost passed out because neither Terrence nor that high yellow bitch was anywhere to be found, and that scared the hell out of me. The only thing that came to mind was that Terrence had taken her somewhere to fuck. I know I shouldn't have been thinking that way, but sometimes you've just got to face the facts. Terrence was always horny and loved spontaneous sex. We'd done it everywhere and anywhere in the few months we'd been together. The freakier the situation, the more he seemed to like it. Now it looked like he'd taken that bitch into an alley, or perhaps the restaurant bathroom, and was doing to her what I'd expected to have done to me. I could feel the tears threatening to run down my face. Before then, you couldn't have paid me $1 million to believe Terrence would do this to me. I lowered my head on the table and let the tears flow. Part of me wanted to get up and check the bathroom or the alley behind the restaurant, but I was scared of what I might find. How the hell could this be happening to me?
Miss, you okay?
Don't ask me how long I had my head down, but when I looked up, the waitress was standing there.
No, I'm not all right. Do I look all right to you? I snapped.
Look, I was just trying to help. She started to walk away.
Hey,
I called to her and she turned around. I'm sorry, I just saw my boyfriend leave with another woman. I'm a little pissed, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, if you're going to be pissed, that's a good reason. These men are getting bolder and bolder these days.
I didn't reply. I just sat up and wiped my eyes. Hey, how about a drink on the house? You want another apple martini?
Can you bring me something strong? Real strong.
I lowered my eyes to the table again.
Sure. How about a Long Island iced tea?
Yeah, that'll work.
Thanks.
She walked away. When I finally looked up again, every muscle in my body tightened as I spotted that high yellow bitch coming from around the corner that separated the restaurant from the bar. That bitch had the nerve to be adjusting her ponytail as she headed in my direction. A vision of Terrence holding onto her ponytail as he screwed her from behind in the bathroom stall popped into my head and I became furious. The closer she got, the angrier I got. Oh, it was about to be on.
Is your name Donna? She asked rudely when she reached my table.
She had the nerve to look like she was trying to hide a smirk behind a smile, and her body language was saying, yeah, bitch, I just fucked your man and it was good.
I wonder if she was actually going to have the nerve to speak those words to me.
I held on tight to my purse, because if she said something smart, I was going to beat her ass with it.
I stood quickly and was in her face.
Yeah, I'm Donna, bitch. Why?
She took a step back as if she was surprised by my aggression.
Your boyfriend asked me to give this to you. She raised her hand and I lifted my purse in the air. If she made one wrong move, they were going to be picking her ass up off the floor.
That's right, bitch. He's my boyfriend. My man, I growled.
I'm sorry, but I couldn't keep that shit in.
She took another step back, raising both her hands defensively.
Look, I don't know what the problem is, but I'm just the hostess here. I'm not looking for trouble. Your boyfriend asked me to give you this note. I'm sorry. I would have given it to you earlier, but I had customers who had to be seated in the restaurant. She waved her hand, and that's when I noticed the folded paper in her hand.
What's this? I snarled.
I don't know. He just asked me to give it to you. She handed me the note. I felt stupid for jumping to conclusions once I saw my name written with hearts around it.
Look, I'm sorry about the way I acted. I'm PMSing. I lied.
Whatever, she replied, then walked away in a huff. That's when I realized half the bar was staring at me and I just made a real ass out of myself. I sat down and unfolded the note. Hey, baby, I see you over there in that sexy skirt. It's a real turn-on. Look, I've decided that maybe we should skip dinner and get right to dessert. I've kind of fixed up something special for you across the street at the Howard Johnson Motel. I'm in room 345. Why don't you come over and join me? T.
As stupid as I felt about wanting to fight the hostess, I had to smile. Terrence was always coming up with some creative way to make my life interesting. A million things ran through my mind as I thought about what type of surprise he might have waiting for me in that hotel room. With him, you just couldn't be sure. One thing I was sure of, though, it was going to involve some mind-blowing sex. Like earlier, just the thought of having Terrence inside me had my panties moist. I glanced around for my waitress, then ended up just leaving a $20 bill on my table and rushing to the door.
Chapter 3. Dante. When I entered the church, I was greeted by the loud cackling of women gossiping, then a sudden silence. I smiled as I approached the 30 or so women of the First Jamaica Ministries award-winning women's choir standing in the church recreation area. Hi, Dante, one woman smiled. What's up, Latrice? I replied with a nod. That started a chain reaction of greetings, shy waves, and blushing if I happened to make eye contact. The women seemed to part like the Red Sea to allow me to pass through and enter the hallway to my office. I could feel their eyes still on me. I thought I even heard a few sighs. I've been given this type of attention from the young women of the church for years, and it seemed like most of their mothers encouraged it. As the son of the bishop, I was treated like royalty, the crown prince of the church. As with all princes, Every young woman in the village wanted to be my princess. For years, I'd taken advantage of that, fooling around with half of the young women in the congregation. Strip clubs and bars didn't have anything on a good church function if you were looking to get some. I walked into my office and closed the door. I sat behind my desk and listened to the women of the choir leaving. Then I checked over the schedule for the youth basketball league, which I ran as director of church activities. Not long after I sat down, there was a knock on the door. A knock I'd been expecting ever since Shorty and I pulled in front of the building. I got up and approached the door. But there was no need. The door opened before I could get there. I stopped dead in my tracks when I realized it was not my mother as I had expected. It was the vibrant and sexy Anita Bell, the only woman I'd ever loved, or at least thought I'd loved. Anita. I gasped as my eyes quickly roamed over her body. Anita was dressed in a very conservative white church dress with white heels, but her voluptuous body made anything she wore look provocative.
Dante, she smiled. I guess some things never change.
What's that supposed to mean? I tried to play it cool, but I was truly confused until Anita pointed at my crotch. I looked down and cringed. When it came to Anita, it was obvious which one of my heads was in control. I lowered the folder I was holding to cover my swollen manhood.
Don't hide it now. I've already seen it.
She smirked, locking the door, then stepping closer to me. She kissed me with her full lips.
I missed you, Dante, she whispered.
She kissed me again before I could respond. This time, she wrapped her arms around me and I did the same, closing my eyes. Our kiss was so passionate, it took my breath away. When it was finally over, we stayed wrapped in each other's arms and stared lustfully into each other's eyes.
God, I missed you, Dante,
she whispered as her right hand moved from my backside to my crotch.
I missed you too, I said as I gently pushed her away. Just not enough to commit adultery. Where's your husband?
Anita took a step forward and looked up at me with a frown.
Why'd you have to go and mention him?
I don't know, I said sarcastically. It seemed kind of important when I realized you were unzipping my fly. Anita sighed. So where is he, Anita? Where's your husband?
He's at our new house, unpacking our things. But you don't have to worry about that. Only thing you need to be worried about is what's in front of you. I want you, Dante, and I missed you. I've been thinking about you every day since I left.
I looked at her and my mind traveled down memory lane. Anita and I have been lovers for almost 2 years, although very few people other than Shorty and my sister knew about it. We'd kept things on the low because Anita was my father's secretary and 10 years my senior. The age difference didn't bother me, though. I wanted to tell the world. As far as I was concerned, I was going to marry Anita. But Anita was scared and wanted to keep everything a secret. She swore that my mother and father would never go for us being together. That's why she started dating Deacon Robert Emerson behind my back. Deacon Emerson was an arm amputee in his early 40s. He was well known around the church and had considerable assets. He'd been trying to get Anita to date him since she started working at the church. For almost 4 years, she told him no. But one day, she agreed to go out with him. 3 months later, much to my chagrin, they were married and moved to Florida at Anita's request. She knew she needed to get as far away from me as possible. She may have denied it then, but she was in love with me. Now, a little under a year later, she and the deacon were back, and since she had mentioned a new house, it appeared they were back to stay.
I love you, Dante. And now that your father has given me my old job back, we can get right back to doing everything the way we did before. And I mean everything.
She posed flirtatiously and gave me this sexy look that made my hard dick even harder.
What about your husband? What about him? We kept your parents in the dark for almost 2 years. What makes you think we can't keep his stupid ass in the dark, too?
She stepped closer, rubbing her hands on my chest the way I liked it.
I need you, Dante. I need your love and I need your body. He can't satisfy me the way you can. I haven't had an orgasm since I was with you.
She pouted like a child who had been punished.
I thought about how easy it was for me to satisfy her. I knew Anita's body better than I knew my own.
I ran my finger down her spine and she shuddered with excitement. Then I lowered my head and blew in her ear. Anita moaned.
How could the deacon not be able to do that?
I wondered, then smiled at my own ego. Anita was my pussy. She had always been my pussy. I looked at her. I looked at her in the manner a man reserves only for his woman. Oh, those feelings were starting to come back. But instead of making me warn her, they made me angry. I pushed her away.
Well, I don't want you. Not if you're married. Not if you're his wife instead of mine.
What are you doing back here anyway, Anita?
I hated Florida. I hate him. I needed to get back to you. I love you, Dante, and I'm never gonna let you go. Please, baby, let me show you how much I love you.
She begged. I didn't say a word. I just silently watched Anita unbutton her dress until she was no longer wearing a conservative church dress. She was still wearing all white, though. A white push-up bra, white panties, white garter belt with white stockings, and of course those sexy white stiletto heels. The contrast against her mahogany skin was stunning.
Please, baby, let me show you how much I love you.
Anita rubbed her hands on my chest again, then kissed me gently before she started to slowly kneel. I knew what she was about to do and was virtually powerless to stop her. Oral sex was my weakness, and Anita was an expert.
I can't do this, Anita,
I whispered repeatedly, but that didn't stop her from struggling with me to get my pants down. Finally, I just decided to give in. When it came to Anita, my big head went on autopilot and my little head took over. I placed my hand gently on her hair and stared blankly at the wall as I waited eagerly for the pleasure she would soon give me. Anita licked her lips as she stared at my pulsating manhood, and I could tell she was preparing to swallow it whole. Unfortunately, before she could move, there was a knock on the door and a jiggling of the doorknob.
Dante, are you in here, son?
My mother called through the door. Without thinking, I instinctively answered,
Yes,
as both Anita and I stared at each other with panicked expressions. We knew that if I didn't open that door quickly, my mother, a suspicious woman by nature, would put two and two together the second she saw Anita in my office. And Lord help us both if she had Deaconess Wright with her, as I suspected. Anita reached down and picked up her dress, then turned back to me, looking to get some direction.
Hide!
I was as panic-stricken as Anita. I fumbled with my belt buckle as she glared at me.
Where?
She asked. My eyes searched the room for a hiding place. I jumped when my mother knocked on the door again. I pointed toward my desk.
Dante, open this door,
my mother said sternly.
Under my desk,
I whispered to Anita. She scrambled over there as I approached the door. I waited until she was out of sight, then opened the door. My mother and my father greeted me.
Have you been drinking?
No, Ma, I replied, opening my arms to give my mother a hug. In my mind, I was cursing the woman in the black continental.
Damn, that bitch Deaconess Wright lied on me again.
My mother sniffed me like a dog as she kissed my cheek, then smiled with satisfaction. If I knew her, she'd been defending me tooth and nail and now felt vindicated.
Why was this door locked?
Huh? I searched my mind for an excuse as my mother stared into my eyes.
Because I was changing my clothes and I didn't want any of the women's choir walking in and seeing my private parts. I just came from the gym and wanted to get out of those sweaty clothes.
I casually turned my back and zipped up my pants as my mother walked by. She was surveying my office as if she knew I was lying. "Hey, Bishop," I offered my father my hand, still keeping my eyes on my mother and my desk. "So, what brings you two down here?" My mother's suspicious look instantly became a jubilated smile, and she spoke before my father had a chance to get out a word. "Oh, Dante, we have the best news. Come sit down so we can tell you." I moved over to my desk quickly and sat down. My father had a habit of sitting at my desk, and that wasn't something I could risk right now. As my parents settled in the chairs on the other side, I glanced under my desk. Anita, still half naked, smiled at me. I pushed my chair back about a foot when she stroked the inside of my leg. I knew Anita too well. She was a freak, and I wouldn't put it past her to try something crazy, like pulling out my manhood to finish what she tried to start earlier. "So, what's this great news?" I asked, subtly removing Anita's hand as she tried to unzip my pants.
"Well, Dante?"
My mother turned to my father with a huge smile. She looked like she was gonna bust a gasket, she was so excited.
"I'm going to let your father tell you."
I turned my attention to my father, who leaned forward with a paternal smile.
"Well, son, your mother and I just found out you've been accepted into Howard University's School of Divinity."
"I have?" All expression left my face as I looked from one parent to the other, then back again.
"You sure have, son," my father smiled.
"Dante, I'm so proud of you."
My mother had tears in her eyes.
"But I never applied to Howard's School of Divinity," I stuttered.
"I know. I applied for you."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.